Hey, good morning, good afternoon, or good evening. I don't know where you're based at the moment. I'm currently based in the morning. Morning time, and it's just great to have you here with us for this third virtual pack. In fact, so it's named the Jurassic Pack. I hope you enjoyed the current presentation, the video, so it's the intro video. We have added a lot of content this year. You will see, I remember last year that we had some remarks about the content that were funny, so we were obviously trying to do that more. I have a small problem here. I'm not able to share my screen. That's interesting, I think. That's my mistake. All right, here it is. All right, so welcome everyone.
That was the first minute of stress.
So 2 minutes of stress for 24 hours. That's unfair. All right, so welcome everyone. So we are going to be together during 24 hours. Of course, you don't have to stay with us 24 hours. But if you want, you can, and I will be really appreciative the fact that you are following us during 24 hours. So my name is Henrik Rakset. I am I'm Dr. Rakset today. I'm Dr. Rakset. So call me Dr. Rakset. So I am the adventurer, and I welcome you everyone to this island. So we have detected this island this summer, and we have created all the infrastructure. You will see we prepared a lot of things. So basically, I'm being in the performance industry in 15 years, and I'm a big Lego fan. I'm a big kid. I'm a bit of geek as well. You will see that if you give themes like the Jurassic Pack, then you can discover weird stuff happening on the social networks or in your the slides that will come in next. So first of all, for those who never heard about the pack, I'd like to welcome on board for this adventure. Since 3 years now, we've organizing now 5 events, and today it's this our 6th event. And we did also a couple of pack meetup as well. If you had the chance to be locked down like we did, we were in France. We organized a pack meetup during 1 month, more than 1 month in fact, just to keep the community up to speed. So the main spirit of the pack is basically sharing expertise, knowledge about performance. So it's more about another tool. Agnostic is the tool agnostic event, and the idea is to bring experts or anyone to share things with our community. So the idea is that makes performance testing great again. So that was the quote for the last pack. So we did we started the adventure of the pack 3 years ago, like I mentioned, with the first pack man, and it was happening in Scotland, and a couple of pack members of today's event were there in Scotland. It's cool to have everyone following us since 3 years. Then after that, we created our first pack, virtual pack. So you were a bit new to that. So that was 3 years ago. And then we continue with the pack in Chamonix. That was pretty great. I thought it was pretty awesome, that location. The activities and everything, that was pretty good. And we follow up with the Pack to the Future that we did last year. And I think it was pretty fun. I hope that you enjoyed it as well, the old content. We had this year the chance to join 14 experts in Greece, in Santorini. So that was the last physical pack. And we don't know if we will have our other physical pack next year, but let's cross fingers, maybe we'll have, but at least the virtual pack, it will be there for sure. So the idea of the pack, so for those who've been following us, this slide is not new. I'm not going to reinvent myself. I'm just going to use some content here, but the idea is that the pack here, anyone can be part of it. If you're working in a project where you are implementing any analysis methods or designing method that is pretty awesome, or anything that basically could be reused somewhere else in another context, definitely you should be part and present your work. You should, if you're not afraid of speaking or creating content, then you are definitely someone that we are looking for. So don't be shy. We are the registrations open for anyone. We are usually submitting the call for papers in LinkedIn and Twitter. So just follow us, and you'll be aware of the next events. So I think today, and why there are obviously couple of challenges with the technology that we are dealing with. I mean, first of all, there are the methods and the fact of changing from a waterfall to agile or DevOps, measure the same thing. You don't deliver the same way that we used to do. Depending on technology or IoT or blockchain or anything, the way of measuring, of course, is completely different. So this is also that brings a lot of questions. So there are definitely with new technologies, there are questions that pops up, especially on how can I load test that, or how can I measure performance. So that's why the pack is here to answer those questions, because there's of course someone in somewhere that has worked on that technology that could help us for sure. So don't be shy, like I said, if you've been working on those type of projects or anything that could help the community, please contribute, please learn us, teach us. That's the core message and core spirit of the pack. So for today, all right, so that's enough for describing the pack. So we picked this year the theme of the Jurassic Pack. So like I said, we wanted to bring methods and the core basics of performance. And you will see today in today's event, there is a plenty of presentation that are pretty much related to analysis, to how to understand, how to visualize data and understand what's going on and report properly. A lot of things about automation. How can I automate and give a right status out of my automation? So all those questions will be answered, and we will see that we have organized our day on in a specific structure to follow the 24 hours live stream. So Jurassic Park means dinosaurs. So I don't think that we have performance engineers dinosaurs. I don't think so. But we were looking for those performance engineers that were helping us back in the old days to analyze, to bring methods for us. So this is why Jurassic Park is here. So let me explain how we were able to bring all those great performance engineers in our park, because it's been a challenge. We did a lot of research. That's a small video just to introduce, to explain that. Okay, so I just got the information that you're not hearing the audio of the video, so we'll figure out later on how we can resolve that. Sorry for that. Basically, we were explaining that we have the chance to get mosquitoes, so all those performance engineers has been bite by mosquitoes, and that's how we were able to recreate and clone the DNA. So today we have clones of performance engineers. So we have a structure of our park with specific sections. Each section of the park has spinners around the globe. We will see, we will visit the island by covering one region and one type of performance engineers, and we'll follow it during 24 hours. So we will start with the Down Unders or Zoras. It's a species that is pretty mature in the performance world, who loves data. So usually you have to, and they're able to take advantage of that and survive in complex environments. Then we will continue with the other region, which is the Diplo Asian Hodus. They will explain first the frustrations of being locked down, and we will also cover a couple of techniques related to IoT and specific protocols like XMPP, for example. We will then cover a large regions where the Euro Osaurus, there are various different, a lot of species, different species, one more relations and analysis. Others are more on the data as well. So I think they are pretty much brothers with the Down Under Zorus. You will see that. So it's a really interesting a species, the Euro Osaurus. You will find it more. Then we'll jump to a totally different type of species. This is the financial Osaurus. We have only three examples of species that we were able to clone. It's going to be interesting as well. You'll see that it's pretty good region to look at. And we will finalize our day with the last region of the park, which is the Silicon Osaurus. And for those who wants to have today we have a guest of honor coming from a large streaming platform, so he will talk about one of the products that I built to analyze cloud cloud and all the type of data. All right, so like I mentioned, so this is the park. We are currently at the entrance of the park, and we have a different type of vehicles to travel. So we picked the latest model of Blue Jeans, which is a really good vehicle, so completely self-driving. So stay safe, check the vehicles. You can grab some coffee. Don't worry, you don't have to drive. Just enjoy the park. We invested so much in the park, you will probably enjoy it. So we'll start with the down on resource with Srivalli, followed by Steven, and we have Scott Stevens, who joined us for the pack meetup. And last would be Arinder as well. We will follow with the Diplo Asian Odus with Harry, Hema, and Ramya. And of course, we'll go to the Euroosaurus with Stain. I think it's a brother from the Down Under's Orders, who will be pretty much also eating a lot of data as well. We have, of course, have Andy in that region, Alan Gordon, Roman, Joey. It's almost the Padawan of Stain. You will see he has great techniques. It's going to be pretty awesome. He's, I love his presentation, by the way. And Luca from ICMS. The on the financial Osiris, we'll have Todd Capua. We are our great partners from Colombia. I see that Andres is connected, so hi Andres, thanks to be here. We have Alex Podolko. We move on to the Silicon Osiris region with Sophia. From Aptim, we have Martin Steer from Netflix. We have Mark Tollinson from our good friend from Perfbytes. We have also someone from Patrick Hankins from Gremlin. And last, we have Leandro Melendez, Senior Performo, who will finish my day, my marathon. So it's glad to have Leandro finishing the day first. All right, so let's start with the down under Osiris region. So let's travel a bit and jump to that region and see the specific agenda that we'll have in the next 2-3 hours. So Srivalli, she's been in the pack since the beginning. It's almost the beginning, because it's a great speaker. She always brings a lot of value to the pack, so I'm always excited when Srivalli prepares some content. But I won't tell you more. I will shortly introduce Srivalli for her presentation. But that will be the first. So she is going to open the day with observability in the cloud-based solutions. Then we will have our good friend Steven, who just took breakfast and eat a couple of road data. So he's going to explain how to digest all that road data. So he's going to talk about Tableau Osiris Rex. Well, pretty excited on that presentation as well. Followed by Scott Stevens, who will explain how I learned to stop worrying and embrace my inner dinosaur. So figure out as well. And last, we have a new pack member, so I'm pretty glad that Arinder Sierra joined us. And I pretty excited also on the presentation and the content he was able to build. So it's about performance test tools as an equal to performance testing, so we see that. So stay tuned. We have 24 hours, in fact, so if you want to connect and join us, you follow us on your own pace. Everything has been recorded, don't worry. So we will share the video, the recordings in a couple of days. So first, please, we will probably rest tomorrow, have a couple of hours sleep, and then you will share that for the community. All right, so that was my introduction. I'd like to welcome Srivalli. She is going to talk about observability in the cloud-based solutions. when we usually talk about cloud-based solutions, we usually think about microservices architecture. And microservices architecture brings challenges. It could be a way, simplified way of bringing shift left performance testing. But then when you have microservices, you expect to have a lot of microservices. So you're dealing with many, many nodes, lots of data in terms of monitoring. So you have tons of data. It brings a lot of challenges when you have to analyze. So she's going to share one of her recent experience when working on Azure. We'll see. I'm going to tell all. It's going to be a very interesting presentation, I can assure you. What about Srivalli? Srivalli is working in the performance role since many years now, too many years. But she's a good friend of Steven. I know that Steven is now, they are working together in the same company, small world. I'm not going to introduce more because I'm pretty sure that everyone knows Srivalli. She's a great performance engineer, and we are so excited to have her back in the pack because it's an awesome speaker. I'm going to stop sharing my screen, and I will invite Srivalli to on stage. We will, of course, following the discussion for the Q&A, and I see that several pack members are there, so I'm pretty excited. So we'll probably have a pretty good panel discussion. Srivalli, how are you today?
I'm pretty good. Thank you, Henry. Thank you for the lovely introduction. And I'm really glad you did not mention how many years of experience I have, because I'm starting to feel old lately. So thank you. And I actually wanted to wear my pack t-shirt, but it hasn't arrived yet. So apologies.
Yeah, I can hear you very well. Remember that you're not Srivalli, you're a clone of Srivalli. Right? So just keep that in mind.
I actually don't know anything about dinosaurs. When I was watching your intro video, when I saw, like, in the first clip, Jurassic Park on your back, like, I was like, oh, it's like Jurassic Park, but Jurassic Park. Like, it didn't click to me, like, until now. I know we've been talking about dinosaurs, but yeah, so I'm a little noob when it comes to, yeah.
Okay. All right. So I'll let you share your screen, and I will mute myself, and I will see you in 30 minutes. So please entertain us.
Thank you, everyone who has joined in. So good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. Let me just get started. So over the last decades, over the last decade or two, we have come a long way from giant mainframe systems through to two-tier, three-tier architecture, and now we are living in the world of microservices and containers. So I think when the software, the platforms change, I think it's quite important for us as performance engineers to keep ourselves up to date. It's not so much about learning the buzzwords, but really just to make sure that we are adapting the way we test and monitor and troubleshoot the systems. So I thought in this talk, I'll share some of my recent learning experiences that I acquired, started working on cloud-based microservices solution. So I'm not pretending to be an expert here, but I thought hopefully my learnings will help someone else who is just getting started in that space. So I'm going to use Microsoft Azure as the technology because that's what I've been working on, but hopefully it should still be relevant in other cloud platforms as well. Before I proceed any further, let me just give a really quick intro of what microservices are. So in simple terms, microservices are like mini applications that are quite atomic in nature. So what I mean is that they can be independently developed, deployed, and scaled. Also, microservices allow a variety of choice of technology stack. Like, for example, in the same solution, you can have some components that are developed in the .NET and you can have some components that are developed in the Node.js, for example. So in that sense, it's like really powerful and flexible. And there are other benefits as well for microservices. Let's say this is like an oversimplified conceptual view of a monolithic system. Let's say this is an insurance system, and we have all the core application logic bundled into the app tier, application servers, and your data is stored in the database tier. So you have run a load test and you're starting to see like a slow performance. When do you begin with the troubleshooting? Well, you could start with the lower hanging fruit, like monitoring the app servers and databases and starting to isolate if it's application issue or if it's a database issue, but that's just really a starting point. If you want to dig any deeper to find what the issue really is, then you'll need to have the right profiling in place and have the right access to attach to enable that profiler in the code. And even if you did all that and you are looking at, say, a call trace output, it would be really challenging to understand that you see a lot of activity like method A calling B and B calling C, but it would be hard to interpret, get more visibility into what's going on. Let's now say the same application is built in microservices. Again, this is like a high-level conceptual view. So instead of having just one app where all your logic is, now you'll have multiple smaller apps, each doing one specific thing. So you might have, let's say, one app that performs nothing but calculating premium, and you might have an app that does like reference data lookup, enriching. And so when I started working in microservices, I realized that now I have a more granular visibility into the solution that I previously did not have in the monolithic system. But having said that, it could still be overwhelming because instead of monitoring a couple of app servers, now you have like 20 different apps to monitor or 10 different databases to keep an eye on. So it does come with its own challenges. So now let's say you have run a test on a microservices solution and then you are seeing slow performance. Where do you begin troubleshooting? I think the fundamentals are still the same. Doesn't matter the platform, like you'll start with something at the high level and you go narrower and deeper. What I mean is that you could start looking at the platform level health, look at the resource usage for any constraints, and then look at the resource logging for additional data. And then you can go into more detailed application level instrumentation. So over the next few slides, I'm going to talk about where you can find this information in Azure. So let's start with the platform level monitoring. So Before we can do anything in Azure, the first thing we need is to get access to the Azure portal. So it's our gateway to get access to anything in Azure. And also one thing that you'll often hear is the term resource in Azure. So a resource is nothing but, so in Azure, pretty much anything and everything is a resource, like a virtual machine is a resource, or a gateway is a resource, or even like a dashboard that you published is a resource, and it's exactly treated the same way. So one such resource is an app service plan. So conceptually, the idea of app service plan is very similar to that of a virtual machine, except it's a collection of computing resources. So you can run your apps in an app service plan. So you can have multiple apps on an app service plan, or you can have dedicated like app service plan for your app. So when you log into the Azure portal and you search for, which I'll show in a brief demo shortly, when you log into the apps Azure portal, you select search, you search for your app service plan and you open it. This is what it probably would look like. So you'll have different pricing tiers in Apple App Service Plan. So you'll have like basic, standard, and premium. Of course, the higher you go up, the more resources your app will have access to. So, and it is it is not uncommon for a test environment to be using a lower app service plan than your production. So it would be really worthwhile paying attention to that and making sure that you're testing on the right app service plan, because otherwise your results would be invalid. And also, so the menu that you see on the left-hand side is more or less very standard menu that you see for any resource in Azure. So you'll have options to scale up or scale out. And if you click on the metrics tab, then you have the ability to monitor that particular resource. There is a slightly better way to monitor the resource using in Azure portal using the Azure monitor. Hopefully, let's see if the video plays fine. So you log into the Azure portal, and then you go to the monitor, and on the left-hand side, you can see the metrics tab. And then here, you need to select your app service plan. Yeah, just didn't want anyone to find out that I have more access than required, so I just blurred out. Just kidding, but all you're doing is searching for your app service plan in your subscription. And so in the dropdown, you'll see in a moment, you'll see the app service plan. And yeah, I'm selecting the CPU here. So you have the ability to like zoom in or filter for a particular time period. And you can play around with the chart settings. Like you can adjust the scale and everything. But one really cool thing that I found useful, handy, is the ability to copy the link under the share option. Because once you build your chart and you click away, you lose the settings. So if you have the link copied, you can anytime go back and paste it, and you should be able to view your chart with all the settings retained. Yeah, so this, because this is an app service plan, you are seeing the counters like CPU and TCP connections, but if it were a service bus, you would see different metrics like message rate or queue depth. So that's about the app service plan. And so there are, like I said before, you can host multiple apps on the same app service plan, and there is a way like you can break down your CPU usage per app. I'm going to cover it in detail in my blog post. So the next common resource that you'll probably monitor is the database. So Azure does support a variety of databases, like PostgreSQL, Azure SQL, and a variety of databases, but the one that I have frequently worked is the Cosmos database. So Cosmos is essentially Azure's NoSQL database, and it's can scale massively and globally distributed. And because it's NoSQL, instead of rows and columns, you'll have everything in a document, and it's in JSON format essentially. And also with Cosmos database, there is a concept of RUs. RUs is like request units. So in Microsoft's own terminology, they call it like performance currency. So which means it's nothing but a bundle of computing resources that are required for your database operation. There are multiple ways where you can allocate RUs to a database. And why do we even care about it? It's important because, for instance, the databases that I've been working were using the provision throughput mode, which means you allocate a set number of IUs ahead, and once you hit that limit, you'll start seeing the throttling behavior. Throttling is an interesting concept in Cosmos database, because it could lead to silent failures. Let me actually take a step back and tell you why it matters. Like in microservices, like I was saying before, all apps are technically like individual apps, and they communicate over network API calls. So most often, the retry logic is built into the components, because when you have so many components calling each other, when one component fails, you may not immediately want to return the failure to your client or the load testing. So instead, your app might actually retry. So in case of a database, if it's not successful, maybe your database will return a 429 HTTP code. So your app, maybe instead of giving up, it might retry a few times until a set number of retries execute. So this essentially amplifies the issue. You are putting more load on a component which is already struggling for resources. And it is really hard to detect some of these issues because you won't see it reflecting in your load test. You won't see any failures. Instead, all you see is like slow performance. So it is quite important to make sure that you monitor your databases and other components for any such throttling behavior. So in this quick demo, I'll show you where in Azure, like, you can monitor a database for its throughput limit. So you log into the Azure portal and you select the Cosmos database and you search for the database that you're interested in. And then once you click it, so the left-hand menu more or less looks the same. So you go to the metrics tab. And then under the throughput section, you should be able to see the 429s, which will be the throttling failure. So if you scroll to the right, you can see the time range filter. So I'll filter for one of the periods where I ran a test on the 1st of October. So I'm just selecting the start and end times, 2 o'clock to 3 o'clock. And then you hit apply. So as you can see here, you can see quite a few failures, and it was kind of expected because I was running it 4 times slower. But you see that the data is aggregated over 5 minutes. That was because the period that I selected was more than hours. So if you want a little bit more granular detail, you probably have to stick with the maximum of 1 hour period and then hit apply. And yeah, so that's probably as granular as you can get, and you have the ability to export it as well. So that's about database monitoring. So now, so far, we have seen like how to monitor resources in Azure. But there are additional information that you can get at the platform level. So I want to introduce to log analytics. So log analytics is essentially like a data repository or a data warehouse in Azure where you can pretty much send all your log information to one place, and you can query on top of it using KQL, which is Cursor Query Language. So you can write pretty much a lot of data, like event logs or perf logs or custom diagnostics, so a lot of information. So the reason I have used Log Analytics for is to query the gateway information. Initially, when I showed the high-level solution before, I have represented the gateway as an external-facing component. But what happened in the real world was that, like I said, all the components communicate over networks. So all the communication go through the firewall and gateway. Even the internal apps communicate over the gateway. So which means that I can query gateway just to get all activity that is happening in the entire solution when I run the load test. So that was what I was using it for. So we can essentially, I'll show a demo in a moment, but you can essentially filter for the resource, in this case, like gateway, and then you can specify the start and end time, and you can specify URLs and a lot of information. So let me show you in action what it looks like. So you log into the Azure portal and you go to the monitor section. And so you can see the log analytics workspace. And then, so select the workspace to which your environment is writing data to. And so on the left-hand side, under log management, you can see there are a lot of virtual tables. So The one, so there is a lot of information. Maybe your team, if you're using Azure, there might be already a lot of information. So I would suggest exploring. So the one that I used was the Azure diagnostics. So if you're not sure what kind of information is in there, you can always select like a top few records using take keyword. But let me show a little bit more useful example. So I'm querying Azure Diagnostics and appending a bunch of wait clauses to filter the data. So you could filter for a specific resource. Because this workspace is shared across all non-prod environments, I'm filtering for the resources that I'm interested in that are related to my environment. And then you can filter for a specific time range by providing the start and end times. And you can either select it here or on the top in the window. And if you already know which URLs you want to query, you can do that. Otherwise, you can just do a broad search. So I'm doing a broad search here just by excluding some dummy ones that I don't need. And also, you can do a little bit more advanced stuff like calculated fields. So you could use extend keyword in KQL to construct a custom field. So what I'm doing here is that I'm creating a custom field called URL path, and I'm parsing the URL and extracting a portion of it. And then finally, project keyword is like your select statement. So you enter the column names, the field names that you want to see in the output. So you can like stop and run your query at this point, and you should see all the data. But keep in mind that you can see a maximum of 10,000 if you're querying through the UI. You could use the REST API to go up to like 150,000 records. But because there are so many entries, I'm just using the summarize function just to show you what kind of data was in there during that period. So you just select it and run it. And there was a fair error because the URL path that I constructed wasn't a string. So I'm just converting it to string right now. So, and then hopefully it should work the next time. So this is just a basic example, but hopefully it should give you an idea of how powerful a log analytics in KQL is. And here I'm showing the counts, but you can get the response times and a lot of other information. And you can actually visualize in chart as well by clicking the chart tab right next to it. But the way I like to do is that I export all the raw data and then I visualize it in Tableau because we love Tableau. So that's the log analytics demo. So far we have seen at a monitoring in Azure at a platform level. So let me briefly introduce to code level monitoring using application insights. So application insights is essentially instrumentation mechanism. So your development team need to hook in the SDK into the apps to be able to extract information out of it. And there is a variety of data that you can get out of it, and you can query it very similar to using the KQL language. So on the left-hand side, if you see the kind of information, so you'll have information tables related to requests, and you can get traces, exceptions, dependencies, and a lot of information out of it. But I personally think the real value of App Insights is its ability to do distributed tracing. So what I mean by distributed tracing is that, say, when you have a call, when you invoke, make a call, then that particular call might make like 10 or 20 different calls to the different apps in your solution before returning a response. So it's the ability to track that request end-to-end through your solution. So that's where distributed tracing really comes into play. Just at a really high level, how it works is that you might have component A calling a dependency component B, and every request has a unique ID and a set of operations and operation ID underneath it. And so when you call the dependency, your ID is tracked as a parent ID and the dependency has its own ID. This is, again, at a high level I'm saying, and I have left a few resources here which cover in detail on how it works. So once it's all properly configured, then you should be able to build a call graph out of it. So the way we were using it is that when we run a load test in the JMeter, in the header, you can pass a unique correlation ID. And in this screenshot, I'm showing a hard-coded value, but we dynamically generate for each and every request. And after you run a test, and in the test result log, you can see all the requests in all the correlation IDs, and you can pick the slow ones, and you can query the app insight logs using that correlation ID, and you should get all the call breakdown in the results. So I really had to take a moment to credit the development team, and especially the architects on the project, who have been very hands-on and involved with the whole process. So they gave me a bunch of queries that actually get the information out of requests and traces and exceptions and give the call timings. But because we do it so often in the load test, I have ended up building a small Node.js application which automates the process of querying app insights. So I'm going to show you a quick demo of it. So you grab the correlation ID that you're interested to monitor, and then so I open my tool in a moment, and you enter the correlation ID, just select the environment and hit search. And in the back end, it is making the call, API call to Azure App Insights, and fetching the information and building a breakdown of the call. So yeah, this is just a sample example, but you can see that the top level call took 8 seconds, but you can see the individual breakdown of the timings on where the call timing was spent. So this was really handy to troubleshoot performance issues and to understand where exactly in the solution the problems were and where to focus the efforts on. So just to summarize everything, the first thing I would always do is getting access to the Azure portal and to the right subscription. So subscription is like a billing account, so where your resources are. So yeah, depending on which subscriptions you have access to, you can see the resources underneath it. And I would find out all the key service app names and database names so that you can go yourself to the Azure portal and navigate through the components. And one thing I found really interesting was that the way the components were named in the project that I have worked on. So they have clearly named like with the environment name and the component name, so that even if I don't know the full component name, I could just type in the partial environment name and it gives all the resources underneath it. And of course, know the scaling parameters, make sure they were set appropriately in the test environment, similar to the production ones. And just remember, I had an experience where even though you set everything correctly, there might be some background jobs that were set up to scale down the non-prod environments nightly. So yeah, just make sure that all those jobs are disabled and your properties are like properly retained. And KQL will definitely help you navigate around the log analytics and app insights. So I would start exploring the data if you already have access to Azure portal. And of course, knowing the solution, just understanding which components are involved in which transaction. So it gives you a lot more independence into the troubleshooting process. And I think in the world of microservices, the queuing theory comes like, is more relevant than ever. So I would definitely refresh the basics. So that's, and yeah, a few resources that I found helpful along the way. So that's pretty much what I have, the time to cover in this talk. And any questions, anyone?
Hi, Srivalli. So thanks for this presentation. I have plenty of questions, I will first enable webcams of our other PAC members. But I have a few questions from the audience as well. First of all, there was a question saying, if I have Dynamic Trace in the picture, do I need to utilize this? I guess Dynamic Trace through the one agent is already collecting everything and doing the similar thing that you have there, you can do it natively with one agent, I guess.
Can you actually repeat the question, because the connection went funny just for a bit?
So the question was mainly about, can we monitor these Azure services with Dynatrace and get the same type of data out?
I honestly haven't tried it. We have been using the built-in Azure tools. But there might be, I honestly haven't used Dynatrace for Azure monitoring, so.
So I would say yes. But I will re-ask the questions for Andy just to confirm, but I think it's definitely yes. Otherwise, a question for Jyoti, in the audience. So he said, if you're implementing those SDK to instrument your app, instrument your code, is there any performance impact while you enable that monitor?
Were you saying something else?
No, that was my one.
At least what I have found from the documentation was that it has minimal impact, but in my experience from what I've seen, I think although it might have some impact, but comparing to the benefit we get out of it, I think it would definitely be valuable when you're troubleshooting the performance issues. So, yeah. And also, I know Azure does some smart stuff, like if you have too many logs, then it switches to like sampling more and things like this. So, so there might be some impact, but hopefully it's minimal as far as I know.
Right. Okay. So that's a question for me, because I was looking at all those fancy dashboards that I like it wearing and stuff. But what I try to avoid is to run a test and then having an intermediary step where you have to query, collect the data, and then once you have the data, you can start digging in your results. Is there any way to collect the data lively in the test through API calls? So the stuff that you showed us in the Azure screen, instead of doing the query on the UI, just sending every, 2 seconds or 5 seconds, a call to Azure platform and collect the raw data that comes out of that and then sort of storing it somewhere else. Because you mentioned it using Tableau, maybe you can already send over to an external data source, so Tableau can point to that one.
Yeah, I'll tell you what I know. Stephen, I know you have worked a little bit, so feel free to jump in anytime. But so you could either build a dashboard beforehand for the key ones that you want to monitor. So that way, and it can be auto refresh or you can manually refresh it. So that's one way you don't have to query each and every time. You can have a dashboard of all the queries built in. So that's probably one way. But definitely there are other ways to get information out of it. Like you have ways to programmatically, like using the REST API. And I know like the tools like Grafana can be hooked into these data. So it's probably another way to visualize without having to query every time.
Okay, that answered my question. And one thing I concerned, I know you showed us a graph of the max. And I thought that Steven was going to cry when he saw that statistics. So I was wondering, is there a way of what is the granularity of the data that you're able to collect? Can you control that, or is there by default? Because I know that, for example, in Amazon, if you use CloudWatch just for the miner, then the granularity is quite poor. I mean, not poor, it's very big. Especially when you do performance, you're expecting a very small granularity to get more data as much as possible. So what is the default granularity? Do you have that information?
So again, I could be wrong, but the one I have seen so far is the minimum, but I could go up to 1 minute. I couldn't find any way to go more granular than this. So that's the reason I sometimes switch to the max view, because that hopefully gives some information into the spikes. But I'm actually not sure if there is a way to customize it, but from the UI, like, I couldn't find any granular than 1 minute.
Yeah, because usually I know that the cloud providers usually stick to 1 minute, because it's been mainly designed for production monitoring rather than performance geeks. Like, yeah, we are, that we expect more. Smaller.
Yeah, but I totally agree. So the more granular information we have, then yeah, it would be ideal. But yeah.
All right. Thanks for everything. So that was my questions, because I have invested in the Insights API of Azure. That was basically what you're doing with the UI. I would like to do it somewhere else, to have the data somewhere else. Maybe another a load testing product of the market at the moment. Any questions for Stephen or Arinder? So Stephen, yes, you had one question.
Yeah, so it was quite interesting talking about Cosmos database and how it throws 429s when it's throttling, it's reached its resource limit. So that's a really cool thing to know, to say, oh, yep, I'll look out for 429s. So do you have any tips for other common performance issues in Azure and things to look out for?
Other common issues. So we did have some issues that are related to kind of capacity. So, as well as the disk type. For instance, you have different plans in Azure, right? And some plans support some different, like the specific disk types. So if you want better disk performance, then you might need to stick to the plans that offer that, like SSD, or because some plans might have like magnetic. So yeah, that was one problem that we had with some of the calls. So you might run into some problems related to the gateway. Like we said, initially the calls were configured to go through the gateway, and there was latency because every single call, even the internal one, was going through the gateway. So, and after the improvements, so now we have gained quite a bit of time there. So, yeah, so probably network network performance could be one area might be worth investigating. So, yeah. Hi,
yep. Hi, Srivalli. How are you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
Good. I've got a couple of questions. First one is, I basically work on more on the Amazon side of stuff, so all on databases on that side. So is there you mentioned Cosmos database, what provision throughput, is there a limit for the write capacity unit or read capacity unit for partition? Different architecture compared to DynamoDB.
So at least in my experience in the provision throughput mode, so there is only one place you set the RUs. So it's not separated for read or write as far as I know. It's just for the whole database operation. So yeah.
Another one, which is again around the RS 429, I don't know your architecture, but in terms of operation side of things, you know, let's say you've got Kong. Kong also allows you to do the throttling on request, and it can also throw 429. How do your operations team distinguish between 429 coming from, let's say, Kong or a different tier versus coming from that Cosmos DB? Do they have a different like dashboards for it, or is it how do they do that?
I don't exactly know how to do it yet, but I know you can set alerts at a component level. So if you set the alert at the database level, so that should be one way to make sure that it's coming from the database.
Finally, is there any plan of open sourcing your Node.js app that you've built?
I would love to. I guess it's pretty, I know Steven is going to show his cool app in his video, but I'm quite happy to if it's useful for other people. Like, yeah, I don't have any issues with it. So,
No, I can see definite benefit out of that because you can do lots of funky stuff because you might not have access some, let's say you, there might be a restriction on who can have access to production. So having that kind of an application makes a call to production and gets you that information might be really useful for other people. It's my experience from things that I've been dealing where you don't have access to the production dashboards, only limited people do. So having a hook into production and use an open source or anything else that you can view that information, even the business can view it, think, hey, that's interesting what's happening.
I'm actually quite curious about like your experience with AWS that you mentioned, like if you have seen any of somewhat similar issues or behavior, or is the similar things, if like are they still applicable in other non-Azure environments, the way we monitor or query information or anything?
Can you please repeat that?
Like, so I'm just, because I haven't worked on AWS or any other cloud providers, so I'm, because I'm just curious, like out of your experience, if any of these concepts in the way like the environments are scaled or the resources are allocated, is it any relevant in non-Azure environments, other cloud providers? I'm just being curious.
Some of the concepts, I don't know much about Azure, so it will be a bit hard, but I do see lots of concepts like on-demand partitioning. Yeah, you talked about log analytics. We've got similar thing. CloudWatch, you can use that.
Okay.
Then you talked about log analysis side of things where you can see the whole, what you call, there's a name you gave, I forgot. They've got X-ray for that, so you can look at what's happening, the application. So there are similar concepts, different names.
Okay.
Usually they have the same features, sort of, for most of the providers.
I've got a little experience with both, and I found Azure, it tends to be a little bit easier to follow and a bit more cohesive. With AWS, you really kind of have to know your stuff to get the same functionality out of it. But it's all there. It's just, you've got to get ready and, get a console open and that kind of thing. But one thing I've noticed in both, in all cloud environments, is if you've got a service or an API, which is not called very often, then I keep seeing like cold start issues where it has to compile the code again after 15 minutes and then it's slow the first time. Because sometimes you have APIs that might not get called, once an hour or so. And then every time they get called, it's taking like 7 seconds to do a simple thing. I've seen that a lot.
Okay.
So question from my end. So you mentioned about the dependencies with source A, source B. So can I query and get sort of the dependency maps and saying, you see, I was just thinking, say, hey, so if I have an API and I'm deploying, let's say, every week or every day, if I scan it, I can see exactly what has been called, how many times, what the exact flows of calls in my architecture, and then basically adjust and say, okay, today, this is how we should test it because this is how it's been utilized in production. Just not necessarily utilize what you described for analysis purposes, but more about risk coverage or pointing out what should be tested or what should be a part of your performance test.
If I understand the question right, like you want to find a way to find the dependencies of a particular call upfront before event testing, or?
Yeah, well, I was wondering. Say, I'm new to the. I just joined the your team. I don't know how your system has been pretty well utilized. So I want to query Azure and see by looking at the dependency maps, and then with that data to figure out who is calling who, how often, and Bill rebuilds the flows of calls that is going to happen.
So Azure does that automatically. So there is an application map somewhere in the Azure portal. Like if your application has been running for a while, it builds the view. I think I've seen similar stuff in AppDynamics and other APM tools. So that should give like a whole flow of what components are connecting which. So that would be a good starting point, I believe. But I don't quite use it for troubleshooting. But yeah, I think for the use case that you mentioned, it would be useful.
Okay, cool. That seems pretty interesting. We have two other questions from the audience. So one question is, what is the concurrency rate that you have observed while accessing blobs? That is a pretty specific question for Cosmos, I guess, but...
If you
don't have the question, we can answer it later. Don't worry.
Yeah.
One other question I'm looking at it. So Stephen answered. Thanks, Stephen. Is can we configure the garbage collector selectors on Azure based on the individual application performance?
Again, off the top of my head, from what I have worked on, I don't know, but I'm really hoping there should be a way. But yeah.
Okay. But if you don't have the information, don't worry. You can still add a
special
note it down. So then, if you add the blog, you can just put some links at the bottom.
I said, I'm definitely pretending not to be an expert here, and I have learned quite a bit, and there is a lot more to learn definitely for me as well. So yeah, I'm just sharing what I know so far.
And then I remember last year you did a talk about RStudio, remember?
I remember.
I was thinking while you're presenting, hey, we should be, why don't we sort of using Tableau, I know, but you could basically extract, collect somewhere, use R to do all the follow up the connecting the presentation of last year, extracting how you taking R and so on.
That's actually a really good idea. I don't know, for some reason, like if I have Tableau license, I somehow tend toward using Tableau. I know that's a pretty bad habit, but I should start using more open source stuff.
We got to get Stein to move away from Tableau. Tell him to get open source.
Yeah, I think that's probably where it all started. Like Steven introduced me to Tableau, so yeah.
It's not going to be the only presentation about Tableau, but you will see. If you're still with us this afternoon, you will this night for you, during your night time, there will be some presentation. Stain, of course, will cover that.
Looking forward to it.
All right. Any other questions, guys? Any other questions? Nope. All right, thank you so much, Srivalli. That was a great presentation. Everyone, I hope I learned things. Thanks for that. I hope that everyone learned as well. So let's have a small break, and then Stephen will continue the conference with his presentation.